Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And today we are back with another series, another playlist. Yes, it is the Vishnu Sahasranama series, and this will take a long time. We will have to make many videos for this because it's very long. But finally, here we start. Glorification of Lord Vishnu and thousand names glorifying him. Sahasra means thousand and Nam means names. Vishnu means referring to Vishnu. So Vishnu Sahasranama is a very interesting collection of thousand names of Vishnu. So today we shall be discussing the outline of the Vishnu Sahasranama, what it is, and there are many other things which we should know before starting this. Okay. So many times people just go and read and they are unaware of what is going on, why they are reading and what this is all about, how suddenly this thousand names have come about. Alright, so let us start today by taking the blessings of Maharishi Vyas and Dharmaraj Yudhishthir, of course, because he is the one who starts this, and none other than Bhishma Pitama who speaks this. All right. So this is a part of the Mahabharat. So let's discuss briefly on the Mahabharat for those who are unaware of what's going on actually. So the Pandavas and Kauravas have fought this fratricidal war, and finally, the Pandavas have been victorious, and they have been coronated as the emperors of this world. And then the Kurukshetra war is finally over. Duryodhan is killed, and Draupadi and her five sons are also brutally murdered by Ashwatthama. And finally, this war is over, and Bhishma Pitama, who is waiting to leave, to depart from this world, is in the arrow bed, and he is in the last days of his life. This great personality, he's one of the 12 Mahajans. The Srimad Bhagavatam says there are 12 Mahajans. These are spoken by whom? By none other than Yamraj, who is the god of death. He's death personified himself. So Yamraj has instructed the Yamadutas. Yamadutas are the ones who bring the soul to Yamraj. Yamraj, many times people think Yamraj resides in hell. No, he doesn't reside in hell actually. He resides in Pitraloka. Pitraloka is above, it's a higher planetary system, higher than Bhuloka, but it is below Swargaloka. Alright, so it's somewhere in between. You can understand like that. So Yamaraj instructs to Yamadutas that Swayambhu Narada Shambhu Kumaro Kapilo Manu Prahlado Janako Vishmu Ballir Vaya Sakhi Vayam. So in the Srimad Bhagavatam, it's very clearly instructed about these 12 personalities. So if you know who these 12 personalities are, I have spoken about them many times. Please write them down in the comments. And one of them is Bhishma Pitama himself. He is the son of Ganga Devi and the great Shantanu from the Kuru dynasty. And he's unparalleled. Any quality, any trait, he is unparalleled in during his times and maybe thousand generations before and after also. There is nobody who was equal to him. It was simply not possible. Either it is administration or being duty bound, or in matters of warfare, he was invincible. There was nobody who could even dare to challenge him. And he was the disciple of many gurus actually. He was primarily the disciple of Parshuram. He was also the disciple of Shukracharya. He was also the disciple of Brihaspati. He was the only one perhaps who had learn from both the Dev Guru and the Danav Guru together. Shukracharya is the Danav Guru and Brihaspati is the Dev Guru, Guru of the demigods, and Shukracharya is Guru of the demons. So he had learned from both of them, and primarily Parshuram was his martial teacher. And then Bhishma Pitama, he leaves behind a legacy which is unparalleled actually. And then now finally, due to some reason, he has to fight inside of the Kokkurus, the evil side basically. And many times people misunderstand Bhishma Pitama. They think that, oh, actually, there are many people in India especially who are not aware of this, unfortunately. They think that, oh, actually, you know, Bhishma was, he was eating the food of Dhritarashtra and he was actually contaminated and he was not in right state of mind. So he fought against the Pandavas. Sometimes people think he was accepting salary. That is why he fought. Sometimes people think, oh, he had given a vow that I will always see the image of my father in the throne of Hastinapur. So that is why he fought. Well, these are all stupid reasons. These are not correct. These are all false allegations. There was only one reason why Bhishma fought on the side of the Kurus against the Pandavas. Yes, and that reason is because Lord Krishna wanted him to fight on that side, from that side, because Lord Krishna wanted to demonstrate to the entire universe that whoever you are, whatever you have, from whomever you have learned, however powerful you are, I don't care who the hell you are, but if you are standing against me, against Dharma, you will fall and you will die and you will perish. You will not exist. You won't survive. I will come and finish you and rip you apart. So this is what Lord Krishna wanted to demonstrate. And because he is a Paramhamsa, Bhishma Pitama, he is a pure devotee of Krishna. So he is very well aware of this desire which Krishna had. So Krishna wanted to use Bhishma Pitama, use not on a business or a mundane materialistic sense, using somebody. He wanted to use Bhishma to set an example to demonstrate to the entire world that yes, even though you are somebody invincible like Bhishma, who nobody can dare to even challenge, but if you are fighting against Dharma, against me, then you will perish. It doesn't matter who you are. Even though you may be somebody like Dronacharya also, you will still perish. Okay, Drona and Bhishma, invincible, infallible warriors, but they perished. Why? Because they were fighting on the side of the Kurus. These are the crooks of the highest order, and they deserve to be killed and wiped out of the entire earth, headed by Duryodhan, Shakuni, Karna, and Dushasan and their brothers. So therefore, Bhishma Pitama, because he is a Mahajan, he allowed Krishna to use him to set this example. All right. And I will start by reading from somewhere in between of the Vishnu Sahasranama. So what happens is Yudhishthir Maharaj actually goes and asks Bhishma, okay. So Yudhishthir Maharaj, he is now the emperor of the world, and then he goes to Bhishma along with Draupadi and Krishna and Arjun, Bhim, Nakul, Sahadev to Bhishma to ask. So the question is, why did Bhishma go? Why did Yudhishthir go to Bhishma to ask questions? Well, that's very interesting actually. So, actually what had happened, you know very well. If you see this photo, if you see the Bhagavad Gita here, you will see Krishna is there and Arjuna is here. He's basically lamenting that he has to kill his relatives and he's not able to fight. Okay. And after the Kurukshetra war, there was another personality who was lamenting. Who was that? Yes, it was Yudhishthir Maharaj himself. So Yudhishthir was lamenting after the Kurukshetra war. He was, because he's a great personality, he's a great soul. So one of the symptoms of a great soul is he's always compassionate. He always feels that he is the cause of trouble for others. one of the symptoms of a spiritually degraded or a envious or a materialistic person is he thinks that everybody else is the cause of trouble. You will see many people these days, they will blame their mother, they will blame their father, they will blame their husband, their wife, their children, the government, they will blame God, they will blame their friends, their uncles, aunts, everybody else is to be blamed apart from themselves. So that is the symptom of a spiritually degraded personality. And one of the symptoms of a great soul, a Mahatma, is that he always feels that he, because of him, others are in trouble actually. And this was the situation of Arjuna and Yudhishthir. Because they are great personalities, so therefore they always felt that yes, it is because of me that this war had taken place, because of my greed. Okay, so Krishna tried his best to explain to him, to Yudhishthir Maharaj, that oh my dear elder brother Yudhishthir, Yudhishthir was his elder cousin. Yes, Krishna and Pandavas were cousins actually. So he tried to explain to him that, my dear elder brother Yudhishthir, you are not the cause of this war. It was Duryodhan and Dhritarashtra and Shakuni's greed. It was the crookedness of the Kurus that led to this war. It was their selfishness. It was their greed. It was their envy. It was the poison inside them which led to this war. But everything fell in deaf ears. Now it's very surprising that Krishna is God himself, that how is it that Krishna is explaining something to Yudhishthir and Yudhishthir is not convinced. Krishna is trying his best to convince Yudhishthir, but he's not convinced. Well, this is another pastime. This is a Leela which is organized by Krishna himself, so that the world can understand the greatness of Bhishma Pitama, so that Yudhishthir can go to Bhishma and ask questions, and then the world can understand how great a personality Bhishma Pitama is. Because if Krishna would have convinced Yudhishthir, then Yudhishthir would be convinced, and then he would never go to Bhishma to inquire all this. Okay, so Krishna purposefully, willingly, he could not, or he did not convince Yudhishthir. Because see, if Krishna is God, he is there in everybody's heart. Krishna says in the Gita, I am there in everybody's heart. Ishvara sarva bhutanam riddeshe arjuna tishtati. So Krishna can exactly speak those words which will convince Yudhishthir. He can do it, right? But he doesn't. Or even if he does, he makes sure Yudhishthir is not convinced purposefully. He does it. Can you imagine somebody is purposefully trying to convince you, at the same time not make you not convince? It's very, it's very peculiar. You cannot understand why. Because you want that he gets convinced by somebody else. So that's Krishna's greatness, that he always likes to glorify his devotees, and therefore Yudhishthir is not convinced. Krishna explains, and then Krishna tells, okay my dear Yudhishthir, please go to Vyasdev. Vyasdev will explain you. And he goes to Vyasdev, and Vyasdev explains, my dear Yudhishthir, you are not the cause of this war. It's not you, it's they, blah, blah, blah. All the scriptural things they say, but yet he is not convinced. Again, Krishna arranges Yudhishthir to not be convinced. Then, there's another level, level 3. Krishna, as the Paramatma in his heart, tries to convince Yudhishthir that yes, you are not the cause of this war. It is not you, it is they. Don't feel bad, don't lament. They should be killed because they are atatais, they are aggressors. They have tried to burn you and Mother Kunti when you were in Varnavrat, in the Lakshagra. They have tried to disrobe your wife Draupadi. Anybody who is trying to violate the chastity of a woman has no right to live. So these crooks must be killed, but no, Yudhishthir is not convinced. Yudhishthir still feels, I am the culprit. It is because of me and my greed that I have fought this war. Then all the other members, they try to convince Yudhishthir, but yet he is not convinced. Why? This was personally arranged by Krishna, that nobody in this entire universe can convince Yudhishthir Maharaj to get rid of his lamentation, to understand that he was not the cause of this war. Why? Because he wants Bhishma Pitama to do that. He wants to give the credit to this great personality, Bhishma Pitama. Therefore, finally, Krishna instructs Yudhishthir Maharaj that there is one personality who can convince you, and that is Bhishma Pitama. So, let us now all go and let us listen to Bhishma Pitama, what he has to say. He is in his final days. He is going to leave this world very soon. And when he leaves, there will be actually, he's not just a person, you know, an entire era of culture will leave actually. It's like, you cannot believe it, what happens when Bhishma leaves. So therefore, it's high time that we go to him during his last days and we listen from him. And that's how Krishna arranges things actually. He wants to do multiple things together. As in Hindi they say, ek teer se do shikar. So, not do, teen, char, so many shikars. So, Krishna, he also wants to give his darshan, his association to Bhishma in his last days. And he takes everybody. He takes Yudhishthir, Bhim, Arjun, Nakul, Sahadev, Kunti, Draupadi, Gandhari, Dhritarashtra, Vidur, all who survived, you know, Kripacharya, then, you know, Yuchu, these personalities somehow survived, they lived, and he takes everybody. And then Yudhishthir Maharaj asks this question. Yudhishthir Maharaj asks to Bhishma Pitama, and Bhishma Pitama sees them, and you can read this in the first canto. This is vividly explained. Okay, so kime kam devatam loke kimva pe kam parayanam stuvanta kam kam achanta prapniyur manava shubham. So Yudhishthir Maharaj says, please tell me, who is the supreme personality of Godhead? He's asking to Bhishma Pitama, okay, mind it. The ultimate controller of the universe. Who is the ultimate destination of all living beings? Whom should men glorify and worship in order to attain auspiciousness? Men and women, both. Ko dharma sarva dharmanam bhavata paramomataha. What do you consider the best of all religious processes? What mantra should one chant to become free from bondage of repeated birth and death? Janma samsara bandhanat. The bondage of janma and samsara. Ko dharma, what do you consider? Which one? Kime kam, kim vape? So, it's a very beautiful question which Yudhishthir Maharaj just asked. And then Bhishma Pitama starts speaking. Shri Bhishma vacha jagat prabhum deva devam manantam purushottamam stuvan nama sahasrena purushasatatothitaha. Bhishma said, the supreme personality of Godhead is the controller of all moving and non-moving beings within the universe. And he is worshipable, master of all the demigods. His transcendental forms and qualities are all unlimited. And he is the best of persons. One should always enthusiastically glorify him by chanting the Vishnu Sahasranama, 1000 names of Lord Vishnu. So indirectly he has already hinted that Lord Vishnu is the supreme personality of Godhead. Alright. So we will discuss the technical stuff later. So this was an introductory video to the Vishnu Sahasranama so that you get the outlook. Okay. Otherwise many times you will read but you will not understand what's actually going on, how suddenly this Vishnu Sahasranama has come. So now Bhishma is about to speak 1000 names, alright. So therefore it's very crucial that you know the stuff, okay, you understand the meaning. Otherwise there are many people who read the Vishnu Sahasranama or they listen to some audio in YouTube but they are not aware of what's actually going on. And therefore, I made this introductory video so that you can actually understand what is going on. All right. So in the next video from this series, we will start reading the Vishnu Sahasranama along with the meaning. And we will also try to give the proper context in which context the things are said. Okay. Because the context is also very important. All right. So thank you very much. And if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me, then you can always go to my website down in the description section. God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him.